بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه، أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Inshallah, today we'll be starting with the Sharh of Zad al-Mustaqna, bi-idhnillah, a continuation of the second part of Zad al-Mustaqna, starting from the Ahkam of al-Imam, Ahkam of the ruling concerning the Imamah, bi-idhnillah, which is part of the book of the Salah that we have started in the first part of the Mahad. And it is a chapter, bi-idhnillah, that go through it. And after that, we'll finish the book of the Salah. We start the book of Janaiz, and after Janaiz, inshallah, we start the Siyam, the Zakat, and the Siyam, and the Manasik. And bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, we try to have them finished by the first semester of this second part of the Ma'ad, alhamdulillah. After that, inshallah, we'll have the breaks, the break at the of the prayers, and also we'll have a break for you, bi-idhnillah, will be 20 to 25 minutes, and usually we'll take it after the Salah of Al-Isha, and then you come back, and if you want to chant that, it's up to you. The second class will be after that, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, so it's going to be a continuation actually. It is Maqasid al-Sharia, the objective and the intent of the Islamic jurisprudence, inshallah. And the book is the treatise of Maqasid of the Ibn Ashur, and we have the method of Ithaf al-Maqasid also that is going to be after we finish the book as a review, and also compiling or reviewing in a concise way the study of al-Maqasid bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. We'll be starting with an introduction with the meaning of the Maqasid, and we're going to have the book, alhamdulillah, the English book. There's an Arabic book which is available on PDF, whoever who wants to follow the Arabic book. Our study, inshallah, that we're going to do, I will be referring to the English book. And inshallah, everyone is going to have the English book, I'll be referring personally to the Arabic book. That's how I studied before. And then you're going to have the English book, inshallah, as a full translation of that book. So you'll be referring to that book for your study, for your review, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. This third class will be, inshallah, akhlaq wa suluk, morals, behaving, and the suluk, which is can be summarized in the purification of the soul. How to purify the soul? Because, alhamdulillah, we have the conduct that we have following the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ by implementing the rules of the jurisprudence, which is in fact the way how to pray, how to fast, how to give the zakat, and all the chapter of the fiqh that we're going to be studying, how to do the contract, how to do the, you know, the dealing and the way how organizing the families, how to conduct the marriage, how to come to do the separation, all those, the book of Tahara that we studied in the beginning, the first part of the Mahad. But the other part, which is the soul that is really guiding this action. There's the belief, which we studied in the Aqidah, and there's the action, which is in the jurisprudence, but there's the etiquette, the manners, the way how to conduct those things. This is in the chapter of the purification of the soul, and the scholars, as when you come to the study, they call it akhlaq wa suluk. Our main book is going to be the book of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala. It is a chapter from the series that been printed and edited and published of the Majmu' Fatawa Ibn Taymiyyah, the whole compiled of the verdict and the fatwa issued by Ibn Taymiyyah, and they also include in it some of his book. One of the chapter or the volume is named Ilm al-Suluk, the knowledge of behaving, which is the knowledge of how to journey, make your journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, considering the action of the heart. So when we're talking about the suluk, it is mainly the action of the heart. That's why we're talking about purification of the soul, the curing of the heart, etc. The book is named Al-Tuhfa al-Iraqiyya, which is being written in Iraq at that time, and he's talking about the action of the heart. But today we're going to be given an introduction of the meaning of the akhlaq and the suluk, and really to put in perspective the subject as I'm presenting it now. We're starting, bifadlillahi wa hamdihi wa tawfiqihi, the chapter or the part of Ahkam al-Iman. I read from the Zad al-Mustaqna. The Zad al-Mustaqna is the concise book of Ikhtisar al-Muqna. So he said, Faslun al-awla bil-imamati al-aqra'u. We said, for example, in the congregation prayer, we have the imam who lead the prayer. The imam, what are the ruling for an imam to be, you know, into the prayer, to lead the prayer? قال الأولى بالإمامة الأقرأ الأولى was the most worthy, adequate to have the أهلية, to have the ability to be leading the imam, to be leading and to be leading the prayer. قال العالم الأقرأ العالم فقه صلاته الأقرأ العالم فقه صلاته. The imama is a position that requires taqwa, requires integrity, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put as imama as you know, a noble position that people, they want to have this position as it has the reward, it has great reward. But also, just in the understanding, in our jurisprudence, the one who leads the prayer doesn't mean he's superior to those who are leading them. But it is a position that someone need to require certain condition to be advanced to lead, to be advanced to lead. And everything into the Sharia, if you study it, and I will start, if you have any question, please you ask question. Inshallah, I will let you know. Everything in the Sharia, as a position, as a task, as a mission, it has a condition. And these conditions really, are related to the mission itself. So the mission itself doesn't make someone superior to other, because the superiority of the to be more honorable in the eye of Allah is based on righteousness. But when it comes to a mission, someone need to have the abilities, the skills to fulfill that mission. And this is actually what we call adl, what we call justice. I mean, you cannot put someone in a position that he would not be able to do it. Why? Because he doesn't have the knowledge. Therefore, the requirement for the mission, for this mission, are the skills who make someone able to fulfill the mission of the imam. So if he going to lead, and he really going to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, standing before Allah require integrity, require piety, require taqwa, etc. But now we're going to see, is everyone need to be taqi, righteous, pious to lead, or what are the necessary requirements for that? Faqal, the first thing, the most one adequate, worthy of the imam, al-imamatu, qala al-aqra'u, qala al-aqra'u. Here the sharh saying, كلما كان الإمام على صلاح وتقوى لله عز وجل وعلم بالشريعة وفقه في الدين ومعرفة بهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كلما كان ذلك أدعى لحبه وحب الصلاة ورائه. Now there's one element that the Imam not only have the skills, but his position as leading require for people to like him. Why? Liking the imam in a way, respect him because of his piety, because of his knowledge, because of following of the sunnah. This is what help the people who's praying with him to have the khushu'. So the most important element in the salah is the khushu'. And the khushu' is the presence of the heart to be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when someone recites the Quran, he want to you know, listening to recitation that help you to contemplate into the ayat of Allah. So that's why the first thing that require like an element as a condition, as the author he saying, قال الأقرأ. الأقرأ, he's the one who has more Quran. Now, قال, as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in Hadith Ibn Mas'ud في الصحيح, قال يأم القوم أقرأهم لكتاب الله. In the Hadith صحيح, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يأم القوم أقرأهم لكتاب الله. Who should lead the people, the one who أقرأ لكتاب الله. I'm not given a full translation of the أقرأ because it has different meaning according to the scholar. قال يأم أقرأهم, here the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم command us to have the one who أقرأ to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he the one who should lead. قال يأم أقرأهم لكتاب الله. الأقرأ has two meaning according to the scholar. قال الأقرأ, it means the one who memorize more the Quran. And الأقرأ also means the one who implement more the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the one who has more knowledge. Now, the difference of the scholar in this issue comes from the fact that the companion of the one of Allah ta'ala alayhim, they use to memorize the Quran, but they will not continue the memorization unless they will implement into action what they have memorized. قال لا يحفظ كتاب الله إلا من علمه وعمل به. That's why we have a difference of opinion. Say, are we going to put the advantage or the advance the action upon the Quran or the knowledge or the memorization of the Quran? قال فقال رحمه الله الأولى بالإمامة الأقرب. And we have also العالم فقه صلاته. The one who knows the fiqh, the understanding, the ruling of the salah. And this is not maybe in all the books, but this is one of the nusakh that it has this adding in Zad al-Mustaqna. اختلف العلماء رحمه الله فيها قال فلفظ الأقرأ اختلف العلماء فيه على قوله قال بعض العلماء الأقرأ هو الأكثر أخذا للقرآن. So some of the scholars, they say, Al-Aqra'u, he the one who knows or memorizes more the Qur'an. وَالْمُرَادُ بِذَلِكَ أَنْ يَكُونَ حِبُّهُ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ غَيْرٍ. And if both they memorize the Qur'an, the one who has more qira'at. So Al-Aqra'u, he will be the one who collecting or gathering the more qira'at possible, you know, base, you know, among those who memorize the Quran. The evidence of the scholars to explain al-aqra'u by the one who memorized more the Quran, in the hadith in the Sahih that Salim Mawla Abi Hudhayfa radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma كان يؤم المهاجرين والأنصار. In the hadith, سالم مولى أبي حذيفة, he used to lead the مهاجرين الأنصار and الأنصار before the coming of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to Medina. Because the latest one who did his hijrah is the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. After all the believers, they made the migration. قال وذلك في المدينة قبل مقدم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. The narrator said, وكان أكثرهم قرآن. So the narrator said, why Salim مولى أبي حذيفة, he used to lead them in the prayer because he knows more the Quran. He memorized, you know, among them more Quran. قال كان أكثرهم قرآنا أي كان حفظه أكثر. وكذلك استدل بحديث عمر ابن سلم and this حديث of عمر ابن سلم ففي الصحيح أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما فارقه قوم أبي سلم قال لهم وليأمكم أكثركم قرآن. The people of Abi Salama, they came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and they accepted Islam and he taught them and he said the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم let the one who lead you is to be the one who knows more Quran. قال فرجعوا فنظروا فإذا أنا أكثرهم أخذا للقرآن. So when they came back to their town or village, they looked and they found him to have the more Quran, and he was a young boy. فقدموني. So even though he was a young boy, they made him to be their imam. Why? Because he knows and memorized more Quran than anybody else. فدل على أن المراد بالأقراء الأكثر حفظا للقرآن. فدل. So we have the evidence that here from these two ahadith, the one who will be the most adequate or worthy to be the imam, he the one who memorized more the Quran, according to this meaning of الأقراء. So the evidence they have, or the ibra, the conclusion, the one who has more, who memorized more the Quran, he the one who's the worthier to be the imam. But there's a condition. أنهم يرون مع كثرة الحفظ أن يكون ضابطا بما ينبغي أو يشترط لصحة التلاوة واعتبارها. They also consider one fact that with a lot of memorization, I mean, if he has, mashallah, memorized, you know, the whole Quran or big part of the Quran, he need also to have, you know, the knowledge of the ahkam of the recitation. Because someone can memorize the whole Quran, but he doesn't know how to read it according to the way of the Tajweed, the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, thus he will not be considered at that time. The second saying, قال إن المراد بالأقرأ الأتقن في مخارج الحروف وضوابط القراءة. The second saying, they say, the one who's al-aqra'u, the one who knows more the Qur'an, he's the one who's more knowledgeable in the way of pronunciation of the letters, and he's better in the way of leading the qira'ah. What they call al-mujawwadu is al-murattalu, recitation according to the ahkam of the tajweed. And this, their dalil, their evidence is extracted from the hadith, from the general meaning of the hadith, يَأُمُّ الْقَوْمَ أَقْرَأُهُمْ لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ. أَقْرَأُهُمْ, the one who, al-qira'a as equality, the other one, qira'a as, you know, the book of Allah, as memorization a quantity. But the conclusion among the scholar, that it is not the point to be muhabbiran al-kitabillah, someone who has a nice voice, but he doesn't memorize or doesn't have enough Quran, he should not be advanced on the one who knows the Quran. As long as the one who knows the Quran also recites with the ahkam of the tajweed, of course. Then the tarjih it will, أن العبرة بكثرة الحفظ. And the ibrata bikathrat al-hifz. So the criteria to be taken in consideration is the more memorization of the Quran, of course, with its ahkam. Now, we might come to a point, a question, that someone can be have the memorization of the Quran and another who has faqih. He had the knowledge of the fiqh. And here, which one will be advanced? Who the one who should lead? Here also we have two opinions among the scholars. The first opinion, ذهب الإمام أحمد رحمة الله عليه ووافقه جمع من المحدثين وبه قال بعض أصحاب الإمام أبي حنيفة والإمام الشافعي رحمة الله على الجميع. It's an opinion of Imam Ahmad and some of the scholars from Muhaddithin and some of the scholars following the Hanafi school of thought and some of the scholars following the Shafi'i school of thought. That they said the one who has more Quran will be advanced on the one who has more knowledge of fiqh. The second saying is the majority of the scholar from the Maliki, the Shafi'i, and the Hanafi. They said if we have someone who memorized the Quran and someone who has more knowledge in the fiqh, therefore the more knowledge in the fiqh, he will be the one advanced. The evidence of those who said the one who memorized the Quran should be advanced, because the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ called أقرأهم. أقرأهم, it means the one who has more Quran. So the أقرأه, it doesn't mean the أفقه. But the جمهور استدلوا قال ووجه الدلالة من هذا الحديث the جمهور they gave their evidence is the one because they said the قراءة is only needed into the first pillar which is the standing. But what if he doesn't know when he happened a mistake how he going to deal with it? Why the one who has more fiqh, he the one who going to help in any condition of omission or mistake to not have everybody confused and he going to lead them how to correct the prayer the way it's been done or need to be done, that because he had the knowledge. And they give the dalil of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala an, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked for him to lead when he was sick sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the end of this prayer. And he said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked for Abu Bakr to lead because he has the more knowledge. But if we come to Aqra, we know at the time Ubay ibn Ka'b, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Aqra'kum Ubay. So if it was the qira'ah, therefore he would have sallallahu alayhi wa sallam appointed Ubay. But as it is the knowledge, he appointed Abu Bakr. The author, as you see, he put al-aqra'u. And in the reality, goes back to al-aqra'u. In reality, it goes back to al-aqra'u. I mean, the one who has more memorization in the Quran, he's the one who more entitled to be worthy or to be advanced for the Imam. Why? Because the hadith is very clear in al-aqra'u, and they answer the hadith of Abi Bakr, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he appointed Abu Bakr as a sign for Abu Bakr to be the one who succeeded him, who going to be succeeding him. And we have the hadith in the Sahih that said in Mawla Abi Hudayfa, the hadith that we already mentioned, he was leading the Muhajirina and Al-Ansar before the coming of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Medina. And among the Muhajirin, there were at that time Umar ibn al-Khattab and Abu Ubaidah and all those, a great companion of the one Allah ta'ala alayhim, which is given the evidence, the one who has more Quran, he the one who's entitled to it. And they finish with their another dalil, قَالَ خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ, the best among you, the one who learned the Quran and he teach it. And in the hadith, قال one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala illuminate his heart with the memorization of the Quran. So these are the opinion of the scholar concerning the who is the worthy from the first condition is al-aqra'u. So our conclusion according to the opinion of the scholar, and after presenting the different opinion of different scholar, our conclusion is al-aqra'u, he the one who memorized the more Quran, with the condition of course that he knows the ahkam of the tajweed, the ahkam. So he recited the Quran according to the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that been conveyed to us or narrated to us through the chain of narration that we have it up to now, alhamdulillah, chain known by its tawatur. So this is the first condition. قال الأولى بالإمامة الأقرأ الأقرأ. Then قال العالم فقه صلاته. He add in this نسخة, in this copy, he add another condition. He add another condition. The condition that he need to know how to pray. He need to know the ahkam, the rules related to the prayer. So what are the rules mainly related to prayer that we already studied, and for those who, mashallah, starting with us, they have the opportunity to review all of that. We have everything, alhamdulillah, recorded. Is the sujood sah. He knows when he make a mistake, when he forget a sajda, what he gonna do, when he forget the shahad, what he has to do. So those are a condition added to the one who's al-aqrab. That's what he said, al-alimu fiqha salat. Al-alimu fiqha salat. So those are basics that someone need to have with the memorization of the Quran to be worthy or the more suitable for the imam. More suitable for the imam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intends for him good and guidance, he will give him the knowledge of the deen. He will give him the knowledge of the deen. Because if someone memorizes and he has a good voice and everything, but he make a mistake and he doesn't know how to correct that mistake, also he will confuse al-ma'mumi. He will confuse al-ma'mumi. Then قال ثم الأفقه. Then comes the one who has the more knowledge. So this is, as the Prophet ﷺ said, if they are equal in the memorization, every one of them memorize half of the Quran, you look who then the more suitable among them. You look at the الأفقه, the one who has more knowledge. Because in the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال فإن كانوا في القراءة سواء فَأَعْلَمُهُمْ بِالسُّنَّةِ. If they are equal into the qira'ah, so the one who has more knowledge in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the knowledge of the sunnah is a knowledge that can be, you know, known or led to, or someone can have the knowledge of the sunnah in three ways. So someone who is a scholar or knowledgeable of the Sunnah is either to memorize the hadith of the Prophet, to study the hadith of the Prophet, and this one they call it hafiz, or to study the fiqh of al-hadith. The fiqh of al-hadith and the understanding of the hadith without memorizing them. And this is here, the Prophet ﷺ قَالَ نَظَّرَ اللَّهُ مْرِئًا سَمِعَ مَقَالَتِي فَحَفِظَهَا. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nadhar, which is give like illuminate the face of someone who hears my statement, my hadith, he memorizes it and he conveys it. Then we have fiqh al-hadith. Fiqh al-hadith. Because fiqh al-hadith, the understanding of the hadith, is also a knowledge, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qala kitabun anzalnahu mubarakun liyadabbaru ayatih. The reflection and the analysis of the ayat is required, is great knowledge, and it is the revelation is said to be reflected on, analyzed and implemented. So this is fiqh wa amal. And the third one is hafidun wa faqihun. So you have the hafidh The one who memorized the ahadith, convey them, spread them, teach them. And the one who make the fiqh of the hadith, who understand the hadith, analyze the hadith, extract the ahkam, so that's the faqih. And then those who compile both, ثُمَّ الْأَسَنُّ Then the one, if they come to the same level they have in Quran, the same level of they have in the fiqh, قَالَ ثُمَّ الْأَسَنُّ الْأَسَنُّ مَأْخُوذٌ مِنَ السِّنِّ الْأَسَنُّ is taken from السِّنِّ السِّنِّ is the age. So the older one. And the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is known on respecting the elder. As in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, قَالَ لَيْسَ مِنَّا أَيْ عَلَى هَدْيِنَا Someone is not following our guidance. مَنْ لَمْ يُوَقِّرْ كَبِيرَنَا The one who doesn't respect our elders. So the order is the one who's more suitable to be in the imam. This is if they are the same in the level of memorization, they are also in the same of the level of knowledge, then we look at the age. The older he would be, the more adequate and more suitable to do that. There's a hadith in this. قال حديث مالك ابن الحويرث that مالكا هاجر إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ومعه رجل من قوم مالك they went to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم they make hijra they hijra with a man from his people and he said we stayed with the Prophet almost 20 days And the Prophet ﷺ was a قال حليما رحيما so kind, caring and merciful and forbearing صلى الله عليه وسلم toward his companion. And when he saw that they are longing to their own families, the Prophet ﷺ said, now you go back to your families. Look what he said. قال ارجعوا إلى أهليكم فعلموهم وإذا حضرت الصلاة فليؤذن أحدكما وليأمكما أكبركما Go back to your family, teach them, and then when the time of the salat comes, let one among you who call for the prayer, and let the older among you lead you the prayer. So here the Prophet ﷺ, he emphasized on order. Now that he knows that both of them they have the same level in knowledge and the same level in the Quran because they came together and they learned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he said, let the order among you who do one who leads. So which this is also to see like Quran memorization, then knowledge of the Sunnah, and then after the knowledge comes as we said, the age. قال ثم الأشرف ثم الأشرف الأشرف is come from being noble, nobility, and this is related to the families. Someone who has the camel from a tree of called noble family, etc. And this is according to some scholar, they put that when they're thinking about people being from Quraysh or people related to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is like from the Mustahab. But the Sahih, this is nothing have to do with the criteria of advancing the Imams, as he's saying here, rahimahullah ta'ala, hafidhahullah bi al-sharh. قَالَ وَالصَّحِيحُ أَنَّ النَّسَبَ لَا دَخْلَ لَهُ فِي التَّقْدِيمِ بِالْإِمَامِ I mean, the reality here that al-nasab, the nobility or what they call the honor of the family or someone from a known family, nothing have to do with the imam. ولكن على سبيل الاستحباب. it might be the scholar that they mention it is more likely to be kind of recommended. You know, when we know people like, when we say nobility, it's not like based on money. We're talking about, you know, here noble, when we're talking about the fuqaha, they look at the criteria of piety, of righteousness. Someone, for example, he's known and he's from family of pious people, of scholars, those they want him to lead them. But it's not a criteria. We cannot say to someone who has knowledge and everything, say, no, this one, he has better family ties or known family that he need to lead. That's not in the fiqh. That's not in the fiqh. And it's not a criteria, as he mentioned by Ibn al-Shubah. And the author mentioned it only, as we said, in a way of you know, giving all the opinion of the scholars, but we explain it that it's not part of the criteria, but if it's done, it's done from istihbab, and it will be everyone willing to do that. قَالَ وَلَكِنْ عَلَى سَبِيلِ الْإِسْتِحْبَابِ. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, الْأَئِمَّةُ مِنْ قُرَيْشِ, the leaders are from Quraysh. As long as they are pious, knowledgeable, like Abu Bakr رضي الله تعالى عنه, وعمر وعثمان, وعلي رضي الله تعالى عنه أجمعين, they were all from Quraysh, they were from السابقين, and they were like المهاجرين. What is the hikmah? I mean, sometimes people also, it's nice to mention the wisdom, because when we introduce such a thing, people, they might think that's kind of discrimination, when discrimination is not accepted in Islam. So when we look at the families here, you know, Al-Ashrafu is not a question because he has better known families or like noble or people they call them, you know, honorable, whatever title they give, not because the other people are lower than them. No, that's what is hikmah, why we have it in the book of the fiqh. And we're saying it's not a criteria. That's actually our conclusion here, as the Ash-Sharah, Hafidhahullah, said. قال الحكمة المراد منه أن تتهيأ الأمور التي تعين على إجلال الإمامة وتشريفها وتشريف من يقوم بها. One of the intent of the Sharia is to have the Imam as a position to be respected. When people, they respect the leader of the Imam, the one who going to lead them, it helped them to have khushu, it helped them to glorify the prayer. Because when someone who's leading, who doesn't have qira'ah, who doesn't know how to lead, people, they will be like, you know, not having that greatness, that importance of the salah, it diminished from the importance of the salah. So the more the one who's leading, he has the qira'ah, he has the fiqh, he has even known into, for example, their tribe by being, you know, good family people, the more respect that they have, the more, you know, likely to have, you know, more glory to the prayer that they're going to be praying. So that's one of the hikmah that this scholar taking on consideration this question. But of course, Al-Atqa, the one who is more pious, he the one that he's, this is the main criteria, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Inna akramakum inda Allahi atqa. Inna akramakum inda Allahi atqa. But when it comes to Al-Mufakhara, to show off with the ansab, that is haram. That is haram, and it's, that doesn't have any place here in the chapter that we study. قال ثم الأسن ثم الأشرف ثم الأتقى ثم الأتقى. Then الأتقى comes, you know, let's put أشرف on the side, and we have الأتقى, the one who is more pious, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the most honored among you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before Allah are those who the most righteous, the most pious, الأتقى. ثم من قرأ, ثم من قرأ. ثم الأشرف, I think I have something missing in this. There's Al-Aqdamu Hijra. Do you have it over there? Yes. I don't have it in my... طيب. I have it in the Sharh. So, ثم الأقدم هجرة. After الأقدم هجرة, the one قال فإن كانوا. This is also in Hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال فإن كانوا في السنة سواء أو في السن سواء فأقدمهم هجرة. فأقدمهم هجرة. So if they have the same age, the one who have his هجرة before the other one. فإن كانوا في الهجرة سواء فأقدمهم سلما. And if they make their migration together, so who the one who came to Islam first? And this is the narration of Imam Muslim. And أقدمهم سلما, it means the one who accepted Islam first. And the hijrah is the migration, but the migration is not limited to the physical migration. The migration is also migration from a state of sin to the state of obedience, from a state of being far from the way of Allah to the state of repentance, and from a state of non-belief to the state of belief. And also can be also as a physical hijrah, from place to place, seeking the pleasure of Allah, seeking place where he can implement better his deen. So this one will be included as someone أقدمهم إسلاما. If it comes to at this level, that equal in all these criteria, comes the hijrah. Then قال ثم من قرأ ثم من قرأ ثم من قرأ is like they are equal to every, you know, at this level, who the one who gonna be advanced to lead. They make a قرأ. A قرأ is a drawing. They draw, they put the names, and someone will pick the name, and the one who the paper that his name in it, he's the one who gonna be there. And this is, will solve all the problem, will not have any conflict or enmity, because some group, they want, you know, this particular one to lead them, the other one, we said, we know, we want the other one. So the Qur'an will solve and settle the everything, inshallah. So this is when it comes to the condition of knowledge, to the condition of abilities, skills, to fulfill the mission of the imam. And this is in a jama'ah, they want to lead the prayer in absence of an imam. For example, we're not talking about the masjid, who has their own imam, we're going to talk about that. Now, it comes to places, this is in general. Now, when it comes to the places, we're going to have different criteria. Different criteria. What we mean about places? If you enter a house, if someone invites you, what criteria? And there's the salah, is the time of the salah, and they're gonna pray together. Are we going to apply the criteria that you were talking about, or there's different criteria? That's what the Musannaf rahimahullah ta'ala, they start. They will stop here, inshallah. We'll meet you after the prayer, inshallah. Straight will come in, inshallah. Rahman Rahim, wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Inshallah, we'll continue our class to Salat al-Isha, and after Salat al-Isha, we'll have the break. We'll come back, inshallah, to Salat al-Isha at 7, right? 7, right? Salat al-Isha is 6:57. And we'll be back here at It's up to you. 7:35? Khair. Inshallah, we'll continue with the fiqh, and then in half an hour, 45 minutes, we'll pass to the next class. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Amma ba'd. يقول المصنف رحمه الله تعالى وساكن البيت وإمام المسجد أحق إلا من ذي السلطان. Now, we said that the criteria depends on the premises, on the places, in which the criteria that we mentioned will not be applied, only with condition that we're going to mention. ساكن البيت وساكن البيت, the one who's the owner of the house. As in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that someone should not lead a person in his own house. وَلَا يَأُمَّنَّ الرَّجُلَ فِي دَارِ. So someone cannot be lead a person who is the owner of the house. وَلَا يَجْلِسُ عَلَىٰ تِكْرَمَتِهِ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. And you should not, you know, there's the places of someone, the owner of the house, he has his own couch, he's on his place, he has his, you know, he's a private thing. So when someone, he's a guest, should not sit without a permission, he wants to be directed where to sit. And that's, subhanAllah, from the etiquette of someone who is being invited. So from the etiquette of the guest also, he should not put himself as to be advanced as imam. When the prayer comes, the one entitled to lead the prayer, he's the owner of the house. So he has the haqqin, he has the right in that. The wisdom of that, he's the owner of the house, so he's the one who's leading in his house, therefore he's the one entitled to lead the prayer. And also the scholar, they gives us more reason, because the one who's going to honor the guest is himself. Therefore, he know what the prayer that he's going to pray. He's going to pray like he will, you know, choose to pray a light prayer, so he need to honor his guest, to bring them the food, he make them comfortable and everything. If you're going to have someone else to lead who doesn't have any, you know, idea about the house or the honoring of the guest or the type of the guest that invited, maybe the person who's going to be leading, he want to, you know, want to make long prayer, so it's going to be really embarrassing for the owner of the house who brought these people, you know, in his house to honor them and to provide for them food, etc. قال ثانيا أنه ربما كان يحتاج في غيابته إلى الناس أن يستعجل. So one of the things, he want to be, you know, taking care of them, and he want to be do that fast, etc. So he the one who's entitled to lead the prayer. قال وشرط هذا. Now the condition that he will be leading. ألا يكون فيه ما يمنع من إمامته. So he's the one entitled to lead the prayer in his own house, but with the condition that he will not have anything that will be objecting the fact that he can be an imam. So objecting means like someone is, for example, who doesn't have the condition, if he doesn't know how to read, for example. He cannot be imam only because he's the owner of the house. I mean, he has the basic of the qira'ah, he has the knowledge of the prayer, that's the one who will have the right to lead. If not, someone else will lead the prayer. إِلَّا فِي ذِي سُلْطَان. إِلَّا مِنْ ذِي سُلْطَان. The sultan, if someone, for example, a governor, a ruler, an emir, you know, who's been entitled, you know, to lead in that tribe or leader in the in in uh, in uh, in the society, in the town. So he has that rightful, you know, position to lead. So if someone, for example, have the president or the king or the emir in his house, therefore that emir, but that title he has over the whole nation or over the whole place where he's governing, he will have the priority to lead. That's why he didn't make the exception, illa li sultan, illa li sultan. وقال العلماء ينبغي لصاحب البيت إذا رأى من هو أعلم وأفقه منه أن يقدمه ويشرفه بالإمام. But there's an etiquette according to the scholar, the saying if the one, you know, the owner of the house, if there's among the guests someone who's knowledgeable and faqih and a scholar, he will, you know, present him, you know, and will ask him to lead the prayer, to lead the prayer. That's min inzali nasi manazilihim, because you have someone, a scholar or an imam, you know, in his house, he's also part of honoring the guest, is also to honor his position and disposition. If he's scholar and imam, he will give him the ability or he invite him to lead the prayer. Then he said, qala wa imamul masjidi ahaqqu illa min di sultan. The same also, the exception of the governor or the ruler apply for the owner of the house and the imam of the masjid. Al-imam al-masjid here is that the ulama, they call him al-imamu al-ratibu. So his position is to be imam in this particular masjid. No one can advance him in the prayer. He's the one who can select someone to lead, but no one can advance him without his permission. The dalil of that, the imam of the ummah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went to Quba to make peace between two tribes, min Bani Awf. He came to the masjid and Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he already started the prayer. He was leading them. And the Prophet entered while they are praying. قال فسبح القوم فلم يلتفت أبي فلم يلتفت أبو بكر. People that start to say Subhanallah, want to warn Abu Bakr that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came. وكان رضي الله عنه خشوعا في الصلاة مخبلا. Abu Bakr, when he started the prayer, he's fully in devotion. He's connected. He's there. So he could not, you know, understand why or listen to them, to the companions saying, Subhanallah. فَسَبَّحَ الْقَوْمُ فَلَمْ يَلْتَفِتْ أَبُو بَكْرِ فَلَمَّا أَكْثَرُوا عَلَيْهِ التَّشْوِيشَ إِلْتَفَتْ. So when it becomes like very noisy, he turned to see what happened. He saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when he saw the Prophet, he stepped back. He stepped back, radiallahu ta'ala. And this is a dalil, this is an evidence, that the one who's already known to be the imam, he had the priority. So even if he come late, he had the right to take his position, and the one who's replacing him, he stepped back and he continued. And this is a full, complete right in the first rak'ah. Qala. Some of the scholars are saying this is specific for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu قال ما كان لابن أبي قحافة أن يتقدم بين يدي رسول الله. It wasn't for Abu Bakr to be in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So some of the scholars say that's specific for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but as-sahihu. The strongest opinion here is the Imam Ratib had the full priority on getting his position even he comes late. وإمام الحي إذا حضر فإن إمامة من دونه إنما كانت لضرورة وحاجة ومؤبيح للضرورة والحاجة يبطل بزوالها. So if someone is replacing or advancing to lead the jama'ah, the congregation, because of the absence of the Imam, is because of a necessity. Then when the imam comes, so that necessity is not, there's no need for that necessity, because he only step to lead them of the absence of the imam. But if the imam is there, then he cannot take his place. قال ويتقدم الإمام الراتب وهذا إذا كان في الركعة الأولى. If it was in the first ركعة, it will be easy. So he will step, and then the person who's leading, he goes back, and the imam will take his place and continue the prayer. Now, if he comes in the second ركعة or third ركعة or second or third or the last ركعة, is also this rule apply? Yes, it does. Yes, it does. So how is being done? He will come, take his place, and at the end of the prayer, so if he comes in the third rak'ah, he will lead them for the third and the fourth rak'ah. At the fourth rak'ah, the ma'mumin, they kept sitting down, and the imam will continue his two rak'ah, and then he offered the salam, they offered the salam after him. And this is kind of, can be assimilated or resemble the way how the salat of al-khawf, the salat of fear, is performed, that we'll, inshallah, we'll study it. But here, the ulama, they're saying, it is also for the imam when he comes late, in this condition that he doesn't know, and the majority of people, they might not know this ruling. They're gonna be confused. So to avoid any confusion and have the salat, you know, continue, he will join the line, and he finished the prayer as a ma'mum. But this is to mention as a ruling that he had the priority for this, for his position as being an imam or ratib, but it's not an obligation that he has to do it. It's optional, it's قال وحر وحاضر ومقيم وبصير ومختون ومن له ثياب أولى من ضدهم. وحر, then he continued, قال وحر وحاضر. قال الحر, الحر is the free. I mean, when you're talking into the society, that they have servant and slavery at that time. فالحر يقدم على العبد والرقيق. The one who's free, he will be advanced on the one who's servant. But here, there's to notify, of course, to ask why the scholar they mentioned, if there's any difference between the free and the servant in the eye of Allah, because the difference between them, or the preferred among them, it will be the one who has more taqwa. So nothing have to do with the status of person being free or not free. But in the scholar, they introduce it because they say, in general, someone became a slave because he was, not following the faith of Islam. And that's, you know, at that time when they get in the battle, and those prisoners might take turn into to be servant. And in this way, the one who's Muslim before him, so you apply like the other person who's hur, he was Muslim before him. But he's saying, قال فالأولى ولكن ليس هناك نص. So the Sharia, he said, there is no an evidence from the Sharia which entitled or instruct us to do so. بل لو كان العبد حافظا لكتاب الله عز وجل أو عالما بالسنة فإنه القلب. So we go to the main rules, to the main criteria. If even the servant, he has more knowledge of the Book of Allah, he's the one who's going to lead the prayer. ولذلك لما سئل بعض السلف رحمة الله عليهم عن إمامة العبد, when some of the Salaf, they've been asked about the leader or the imama or the servant will be leading. قال سبحان الله ومن لا يصلي وراء عكرمة. He said, what are you talking about? Who will not pray behind عكرمة? And عكرمة, he was a slave. ثم ذكر غيره. ثم ذكر غيره أو ذكر غيره. And they've been mentioned others like الإمام نافع, إمام القراء, he was servant. And many of the great scholars, Mujahid and Muqatir, all of them, they were servants. So this is not a criteria to be mentioned, except like if someone has servants, so he was, you know, not following the faith. So the one who followed the faith before him, therefore we go to the other criteria, أخدموا هجرة أو أخدموا سلما. قال ويقدم also وحر وحاضر. What the meaning of حاضر? What the meaning of حاضر? الحاضر, he the one who live in the city. And the حاضر, the opposite of حاضر is البدوي, the Bedouin, الأعراب, those who live in the Bedou. Far from the city. And the reason here, because the people of the city are the people who live around, Al-Bunyan or Al-Amran, which was entitled, to have more scholar, they have the masajid, they have the knowledge, they have the schools. So someone hadir, he's more likely to have the knowledge than the one who's Bedawi, who live far from the city, where, it's really difficult to find teachers or scholars and everything. So this is, which is more likely, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qala, al-a'rabu ashaddu kufran wa nifaqa. The A'rab are more, have more denial and rejection. Why? Because they don't have knowledge. They don't have knowledge, and they are conditioned to be living far from the city, far from the agglomeration, this make them to not have enough people who instruct them or who guide them. So that's the reason why he said wa hadir. But it doesn't mean that the Badu or the Badi, he doesn't have the right to lead. We go back always to the first criteria. If he knows more Quran, so he's more entitled to and more adequate to be leading. So this awsaf, this attribute, this description are all of them ijtihadi. When we say ijtihadiyya, is made by the effort of the scholar rahimahumullah ta'ala to try to collect all the type of criteria in this very concise book. So we only consider those who comes in the sunnah, or they have an evidence from the Book of Allah or the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As we mentioned, for the first one, we have the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but these are ijtihadi. When we say ijtihadi, is more, effort of the scholars, rahimahumullah ta'ala, to give you dhabit, to give you a way how to analyze it, how to view it, to give you a perspective. Therefore, when he says someone is in the city, he's more likely to have knowledge than the one who comes from the Bedou. But doesn't mean that everyone from the city need to lead the one who comes from the Bedou. No. The same thing for the Hur and the servant. The same thing for al-muqim. For example, here, qal wa muqim. Who is the muqim? He's the one who's resident. So the muqim opposed to the traveler. The muqim opposed to the traveler. وَمُقِيمٌ. Why the muqim is more suitable to lead? Because the traveler, if he's going to lead the prayer, he's going to shorten. And if he shortens the prayer, some people, they don't know why he's making tasleem in the second rak'ah. So some people, they're going to make tasbih. Other people, they don't know what to do. So, to avoid any confusion for musallin, then the option or the priority be given to the muqim, to the one who's resident. So, qala, that's why he said, qala wa muqim. وَبَصِيرٌ, someone who has vision, who can see, opposite to a blind. But here, there is no, favor on someone who see on the one who is blind, because the blind might have more knowledge, more taqwa. He memorized more the Quran, so he's entitled and he has the priority to lead. But why the scholar here? What is the wisdom that the scholar, they add this? They said because the blind, the basir, will be, have a priority in some cases. I mean, not in the case when the blind, he has the knowledge and he has the memorization. So if we fulfill the first criteria that you mentioned, the one that we're going to be advanced. But in this case, he said, the blind, he might not know the condition of the people. Because the imam, one of the things, when he looks at the lines, he's going to see there's sick people, there's old people. Those condition who are going to help him decide how long the prayer is going to be. He might enter a place where, for example, a place where people, they can't take a break. You know, they have businesses, you have a masjid in a market. So the masjid in the market, he knows everybody has hajj, they want to go get back to their business. So the salat, it will be like not that long salat. So it's going to be taking in consideration the situation of the people who come to pray. So more likely the one who see, he had this ability to judge and to look. When the blind, he will not know. So that's the only, the scholar they mentioned this, to see the wisdom why we advance the basi. Not based on the knowledge of such a thing, or have, you know, to be favored, or we have an advantage on him in any way, except on this. But he has more knowledge, of course, the blind will be the first to, you know, to have the priority to lead. وَمَخْتُونٌ وَمَخْتُونٌ الْمَخْتُونُ هِي the circumcised. So here the opposite who is not circumcised. So he said two, for example, they accept Islam. One will have the audacity to fulfill the whole, you know, Sunan al-Fitra, the Sunan, because circumcised, you know, from the Sunan, from the Sunnah of al-Fitra, a Sunnah related to the inner disposition of human being, which is like kind of assimilated to, you know, cutting the fingernails, shaving someone, you know, cutting the hair and keep someone clean, you know, that is also from the Sunnah of al-Fitr. If someone cannot do it, it doesn't mean that he cannot be Muslim. He's accepted to Islam and he's welcomed, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive him and will reward him on his action. But when it comes to the imam, the one who accepts Islam and he get to the point to be circumcised, he's the one who has the priority to lead the one who is not. And the scholar they mentioned this is considering the tahara, because the one circumcised, he's more likely to be cleaner than the one who is not circumcised, where, you know, he might not have full cleanliness. So as you see here is a condition of tahara. It's a condition of tahara. Then qala وَمَنْ لَهُ ثِيَابٌ, and the one who has clothes. Because we're talking in situations, sometimes people, they have barely clothes to cover their awrah. So the one who has the more clothes to cover, more awrah, you know, he's covered his upper body, and the other one only has his clothes, you know, to cover just the awrah, and his upper body is not covered. There, the one who has more clothes to cover himself, he's the one who's has the priority. That's why قَالَ أَوْلَى مِنْ ضَدِّهِمْ, they are more suitable than those who oppose them. So when we say حُرٌ, opposed to free, opposed to servant, حَاضِرٌ, opposed, I mean, someone who live in the city, opposed to someone who live in the Badu, and مُقِيمٌ, opposed the resident, بَصِيرٌ, opposed the blind, مَخْتُونٌ, opposed to the non-circumcised, وَمَنْ لَهُ ثِيَابٌ, the one who has the belly covering his awrah. After that, the مُصَنَّف رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, the author, continued to tell us who are the type of people that it is forbidden, or someone's prayer is not accepted, he prayed behind them. So he started by those who's forbidden, or someone's prayer is invalid if he prayed behind them, and then the makruh, the one disliked to pray behind them. قَالَ وَلَا تَصِحُّ خَلْفَ فَاسِقٍ كَكَافِرٍ. the salat is not accepted behind someone who's leading who is fasiq. Fasiq. Fasiq is mean deviated. It comes from the dates when it opened and split on the side is like kind of, there's kind of deviation. So fasaqat al-tamratu, they say. And fasaqa is like come out. You know, it opened and the seed can come out. So it is, you know, al-fusuqu, al-fisqu, it means to kharaja, kharaja, to get out. And get out of what? Of the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So سمي الفاسق فاسقا لأنه خرج عن طاعة الله. He deviated, he get out the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's done by his violation of the law of Sharia, by his disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. والفسوق يكون على حالتي. الفسوق can be have two status. A status of fisq that lead someone to not become to be a believer at all. So it negates Islam, becomes a kafir. That's why qala ka kafir. Fisq is like someone non-believer. Wa fusuqun, someone he can be fisq wal iyadu billah by doing major sin. And major sin makes someone to be doing kabair, so he's deviated, but he's still Muslim. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called al-fasiq, the kafir fasiq, and also called al-fasiq non-kafir, like إِذَا جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَى. He called him fasiq, he was a Muslim, a Sahabi. But أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. In other ayah, it was talking about the disbeliever. That's why we have the fisq has different level. Some of the scholars, they obligate anyone who prayed behind the fasq to repeat his prayer. But الْفَاسِقُ, who is the kafir, الْفَاسِقُ, he is the disbeliever, it is a consensus between the scholar, among the scholar, that the prayer behind such a person is batila, is invalid. Even some of the scholar will go to the point that someone, if they pray behind someone years and then figure out that he wasn't a Muslim, they should repeat their prayer. And there's difference of opinion between the scholar. But someone knowing that the one who's praying after he prayed, and you know that he wasn't a believer, you know, it happened for, you know, in previous generation, some spy, they come and they be in a masjid and leading prayer and they're not Muslim. But then they realized, so their prayer was invalid. Now, but the fasiq who commit sins, the one who commit, you know, major sins. قال الفاسق الذي يرتكب الكبائر الكبائر أو يسر على الصغار. الفاسق, who is the fasiq and Muslim fasiq, he the one who either commit the major sin or he insists on doing the small sin, because he doesn't care. And it opposed the al-adlu. Al-adlu is the someone who has integrity and the one who's, you know, truthful in his deen. So the one who commit major sin and who insists on the sins, the salah is not accepted behind him. That's what he said here. But the scholars, rahimahumullah ta'ala, they had different opinion concerning this issue. So he's saying here, al-Dalil, قال, إن كان إنسان الفاسق تقدم وصلى بالناس فهل صلاتهم وراءه صحيحة أم ليست صحيحة. If someone fasiq He's going to lead people to prayer. Their prayer is accepted or not accepted. We have two opinions among the scholars. The first opinion, they said the salat behind the fasakh is accepted. As long as his fasakh doesn't get him out of Islam. So he's only committing major sin. It's not a fasakh that annul his belief. This opinion is the opinion of the majority of the scholars. And we say majority of the scholars, and we have these scholars that we, our scholar of Salaf, we can summarize them in the four major school of thought. The Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi'i, and Hanbali. The majority of the scholars say majority is like three out of four, mainly. وهو مذهب المذهب الحنفية والمالكية والشافعية وبعض أصحاب الإمام أحمد رحمة الله عليه. So this is the opinion defended by the school of thought of the Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi'i, and some of the follower of the scholar of the Hanbali school. The second opinion. They view that the prayer behind the fasakh is not accepted. And this is, as you see, at the book of Zayd al-Mustaqna, reminding you, is following the Hanbali school of thought. استدل الذين قالوا بصحة الصلاة وراء الفاسق بأدلة. Now what is the evidence of those who defending the opinion that the salat behind the fasakh is accepted? أولها حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه في صحيح البخاري أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يصلون لكم فإن أصابوا فلكم ولهم وإن أخطأوا فلكم وعليهم. In the hadith of Abi Huraira رضي الله تعالى عنه in the Sahih, he talking about this wicked, deviated people. He said, when they lead you to the prayer, they salloon, you know, فإن أصابوا فلكم ولهم. If they do it right, it's for you and for them. وَإِنْ أَخْطَأُوا If they do mistake, فَلَكُمْ وَعَلَيْهِمْ So that mistake, they only be charged on them. They will only be carried by them. But for you, your salat will be sound and accepted. فَقَالَ يُصَلُّونَ لَكُمْ فَإِنْ أَصَابُوا إِنْ كَانُوا صَالِحِينَ فَلَكُمْ So if they are righteous, this is going to be good for you. And if they are not, your salat is accepted. So they are going to be carrying their own sin, and the burden will be the burden on their back or on their shoulder. And this hadith is very clear. قَالَ وَاضِحٌ فِي صَحَّةِ إِمَامَةِ الْفَاسِقِ And he said to Abi Dhar, قَالَ صَلِّهَا مَعَهُمْ فَإِنَّهَا لَكَ نَافِلٌ If there's people that you're doubting about their integrity, pray with them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to accept it for you in nafila. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't revoke or invalidate the salat with the fasiq. The third evidence in those who defending the opinion that it is valid the salat behind the fasiq is the guidance of the salaf and the consensus of the salaf rahimahumullah ta'ala. فإن ابن عمر وأنس وابن مالك وأنس ابن مالك رضي الله عنهم أجمعين صليا وراء الحجاج صليا وراء الحجاج الحجاج بن يوسف he was known by his you know fisq by his killing with no right and he was a transgressor unjust oppressor and ابن عمر his صحابي رضي الله تعالى عنه and أنس بن مالك they prayed behind there so the salaf they knew and no one objecting to pray behind the fasakh and the salat is accepted. The thing is, the fasakh, when he prays, you are following him not in his thinking, not in his action. You are following him in the form of the prayer. Because you praying with your intention, but you are following him in the prayer that he is doing the same as the Prophet ﷺ taught us. Therefore, the sin that he's committing is going to be, you know, burden on him, and that sin will not pass to the people who are praying behind him. قالوا, and the opinion of the Jumhur, talking and arguing with the Hanbali opinion, قالوا الفاسق لو صلى الظهر وصلى العصر فهل تطالبونه بإعادة الظهر والعصر. They said, if this fasiq, he prayed ظهر and عصر according to the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, would you tell them to repeat their prayer? He said, no, we don't. He said the same thing if they read the prayer. You don't tell them, so the people who pray behind them, you don't tell them to repeat the prayer. Do you have any question? Everything clear, inshallah. Alhamdulillah. Let's, inshallah, continue and finish with this mas'ala before we move to the next, inshallah, subject. قال ولا امرأة وخنثى للرجال ولا امرأة ولا امرأة, and it is not valid the prayer behind a woman. وخنثى, and in one نسخة قال مشكى وخنثى مشكى للرجال. الخنثى is the one who is born, you know, not known, male or female. And sometimes, you know, they come to three, let's say, category of khuntha. There's a khuntha who's not known, male or female, but with their nature, they go through the male part, so they be considered among the men. And those who their nature, you know, aptitude that they have, they turn into female. But al-mushkul, he's the one who is not known to be male or female. So this one cannot be leading. This one cannot be leading. But what about the mar'a, al-mar'atu? It is, you know, especially now that we have in some places, you know, woman who's leading the prayer and offering Jumu'ah. It is ijma', is a consensus between the scholar that the woman cannot lead the prayer. And the woman, and the one I was asked not long ago about this question, he said, ask the woman, will she lead the prayer? Ask a woman, noble, seeking the pleasure of Allah, seeking the taqwa. Ask her, come lead, and you will hear the answer. But sometimes someone goes through a lot of analysis without asking those who are concerned. First, it is the fitna. It is the fitna. I mean, if the man and in front of them a woman, it is a fitna. Fitna for the woman and for the man. Fitna for the woman and for the man. But here the opinion of the scholars, as reported from Al-Mughni ibn Qudama, قَالَ لَا يَصَحُّ أَنْ يَأْتَمَّ رَجُلٌ بِمْرَأَةٍ. So it's not valid for a man to follow or to have to be led by a woman. فِي الصَّحِيحِ مِنَ الْمَذْهَبِ وَهُوَ قَوْلُ عَامَّتِهِمْ قَالَ الْبَيْهَقِ وَعَلَيْهِ الْفُقَهَاءُ السَّبْعُ وَالتَّابِعُونَ. So the big fuqaha, sab'a, known in the Medina, and the whole tabi'un, وَنَصَّ الْمَرْدَوِي عَلَىٰ عَدَمِ جَوَازِ إِمَامَتِهَا فَقَالَ وَلَا تَصَحُّ إِمَامَةُ الْمَرْأَةِ لِلْرَجُلِ هَذَا الْمَذْهَبُ مُطْلَقًا, and is not accepted for the woman to lead the man. Now, a very important thing, you know, maybe I will give more analysis in this topic. When people, they talk about this, it's like there is no equality between men and women. But this is nothing had to do with equality. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them equal and created them to be alike, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. The equality comes into everyone's relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. everyone the reward. But there's mission and tasks. There's mission and tasks. There are, you know, entitled for the woman to be preferred in doing them, or entitled for the woman to be skilled for them. The same, there's mission and task. Where is the man? He has to do it in a condition to preserve the purity in the society and to preserve, you know, the integrity within the society. So when it comes here, people, they always take it from the awkward perspective, which is not the way of Islam or even the thinking of Islam. Say, oh, the man, he's the leader, so it's like the woman, she's always behind, and there's no equality, and there's oppression of the woman. I said, that's not the case, because Islam is the one who gives the equality and the full equality between the man and the woman. And the Prophet ﷺ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned many ayat, قال من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن, whoever will do good deeds from male and female and they are a believer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward them with the Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will promise subhanahu wa ta'ala to make them live a joyful life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala قال إن المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات, and he subhanahu wa ta'ala, he put the equality between them in these many of the ayah. But when it comes to the mission and task, what is, as we said in the beginning, the criteria, the condition that will help to fulfill the mission in the better way, in the better image, and in the intent of the Sharia, when we preserve the khushu'. Because when you put man next to a woman, I mean, especially the man, you're not going to think about the prayer anymore. You're going to be looking on the side, and he's going to be, his big fitna is the woman who's sitting, standing next to him, or the women who are going to be leading him. So it doesn't mean that there is no woman scholar. We have, mashallah, in our salaf, great woman scholar who teaching, who have, you know, a great, you know, knowledge and great presence, even, you know, in the hadith, in the fiqh, etc., etc. But it comes to this, you know, it is invalid for a woman to lead the prayer or a man to be led by a woman. قال ولا تصح إمام المرء إلى آخره. There's one narration, but this one narration existed before the Ijma. That one narration on Al-Imam Ahmad, he said it is lawful for women to lead the prayer in the nafil, like in the Taraweeh, for example. وَهُوَ الْأَشْهَرُ عِنْدَ الْمُتَقَدِّمِينَ وَخَصَّ بَعْضُ الْحَنَابِلَ الْجَوَازِ بِذُو الرَّحْمِ. But Al-Hanabila said this is only between relatives. وَخَصَّوا بَعْضُهَا بِكَيْنِهَا عَجُوزًا. And some of them said, no, she need to be like an old woman. وَخَصَّهُ أَخَرُونَ بِكَأَنْ تَكُونَ أَقْرَأْ مِنِ الرِّجَالِ. Some others said because she's very knowledgeable in the Qur'an, and those who's present with her doesn't know the Qur'an. And وَمَنْ قَالَ بِالصَّحَّةِ. And whoever who have this opinion, you know, and we're going to mention it's not the opinion of the consensus that the Ummah that agreed upon. قَالَ تَقِفُ خَلْفَهُمْ وَيَقْتَدُونَ بِهَا فِي جَمِيعِ أَفْعَالِ الصَّلَاةِ. But even though this is how it's going to happen, to preserve that integrity, to preserve the khushu' and not to cause the fitna, she will stand behind them. And they will be following her voice to follow the prayer. وَيَقْتَدُونَ. This is taken from the Ibn Qudamah rahimahullah ta'ala. لِأَنَّهُ أَسْتَرُ لَهَا. Because this is give her more, you know, to preserve her modesty. وَيَقْتَدُونَ بِهَا. This is, they have a hadith. And this hadith, there is a lot of, you know, saying about this hadith. But it's very important for you as a student of knowledge to know how to answer the question when it comes to imama of the woman. حديث أمي ورقة, حديث أمي ورقة, أن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يزورها في بيتها. أم ورقة, she was very knowledgeable in the Quran. She was from the Qurra of the Quran. She was an old woman. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he used to go visit her in her house. قال وجعل لها مؤذنا يؤذن لها. He gave her the permission for someone, he was a very old man, who make adhan for her. وأمرها أن تؤم أهل دارها. And he gave her the permission to lead her family, to lead her family. So when we say Ahl al-Dariha, we presume that there is also men among her family that she was leading, that she was leading. And this is the permission or the opinion to have, on which is based that is permissible for a woman to lead only in the nafila. And if she does, it's going to be behind the man, to preserve her modesty, etc. This is based on a presumption in this hadith. Why? Because there's different path of this hadith, because in the riwayat al-Dharqutni, it has a more specification in which he said, قَالَ أَذِنَ لَهَا أَنْ يُؤَذَّنَ لَهَا وَيُقَامُ وَتَأُمُّ نِسَاءَهَا. So in the hadith he said she will lead the people of her, the member of her family. In Dharqutni he said she will lead the member of the family, they were only women. So there we go back to the issue here. It be solved that because she was leading a woman like her, and we know it is permissible for a woman to lead one. قال وهنا أمر ينبغي التنبه له. And there's an issue here that everyone needs to know, that الإجماع قد انعقد على حرمة إمامتها بالرجال. There's an إجماع. The إجماع is the real شرع. It's an evidence. It is the unanimous opinion among the scholar that is forbidden for the man to be led by a woman. Which is mean when it's forbidden, so their salat is also invalid, not accepted. The only from the Salaf, from Tabi'i Tabi'in, who they have other, opinion is Abu Thawr wa Tabari. Abu Thawr wa Tabari, and also another consist of the scholar happened after the Tabari. So there is no of the scholar of the Ummah who give the permission of the Imam of the woman. And we said for the condition that you mentioned, because those who want to change the deen, they came from the angle that the man is like in Islam, like the woman is a prostitute and the man is better than her. He said, you missed the understanding, because men and women are equal in Islam. But this is something, this is an imam. This is nothing else. This is actually, it's not an obligation for the woman to pray jama'ah, it's an obligation for the man. So how is not an obligation for her and she comes to lead the man when it's not an obligation for her? No. وَلَا إِمْرَأَةٍ وَخُنْثَ لِلْرِجَالِ. I finish with this question. Therefore, what is the saying or the verdict concerning the woman leading woman? What is or what are the saying of the scholars? We have two opinions in this issue. We have two opinions. Hanbali and the Shafi'i school, they said it is permissible for the woman to lead the woman. And their hujjah, their evidence, the hadith that we mentioned of Ummi Waraq. Because in the Ziyad of Dharqutni, he said they were women. And the Hanafi and the Maliki school, they said the woman is not permissible for her to lead the woman. But this is a weak opinion, a weak opinion. So it has, she had the permission, and it's valid for her to lead the woman, and she stand in the middle of the line. For the khunta, we mentioned who is the khunta. The khunta is not known, male or female. So the khunta also will not lead the rijal. But the khunta, he can lead or she can lead the one like her. she can lead the one that came her. I mean, we don't know if he's male or female. And the Khunta was born with two organs, the organ of the man and the woman. That is the Khunta. They have both. We'll stop here, inshallah, if you have any question. If you have any question in the book of Zad al-Mustaqna, in the Ahkam al-Imam, please, inshallah, ask. If not, a few minutes, and we'll pass to the next subject. Question? Yes.
Can a woman have the title of imam without
being afraid? Imam being leader, right? Yeah, she can. She can be leader in many things. It's the only... Can a woman have a title of imam? If the imam we know, we mean with it the linguistic meaning, she's a leader, she can be a leader. She can be an imam in the field where it's permissible for her to be imam. But when we say imam, as definition of imam, the one who lead the prayer, we say no. But it's very important to understand, nothing will diminish from the moment to not be entitled to be imam. Actually, to preserve her chastity. Preserve. That's why I say, if you ask a woman, you know, the woman who's like, you know, have that humbleness, the humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she will refuse to be in front of the man. So it's actually to not put her in an embarrassment, in such a position that she will not maybe handle it. So it's going to be fitna for her and fitna for the one who's going to pray with, behind her. The salat, what is the objective of the salat? It's standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's no mingling, there's no... So it's like the focus is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the best disposition to have full focus? First to separate men and women. Because the biggest fitna for the man, maybe the sister, they don't know that. The biggest fitna for the man is the woman. Is no one. I mean, alhamdulillah, Islam, how he safeguard the dignity and the honor of the women by, you know, treating them as pearls. But if you look at the commercial now, it's like, you know, it's the women, they use it as a commodity. Everything has a picture of a woman, right? Even weapons. Sell weapon, you say, like a woman holding a rifle or something. What has to do with the rifle? So the dignity that been and the honor given to Islam is by protecting her, covering her, preserving her chastity, her purity, all of that. That is the spirit of the Sharia. So not to put her in a position when she's going to take conflict with her own nature of being humble, shy, modest. Any other question? Anyone who approaches this subject to show that is there's inequality is enough the ayat of the Quran to answer him, because the ayat of the Quran shows us the equality between men and women. And there is no advantage on a man or a woman, on a man, except by piety and righteousness. No, for the opinion of not Hanafi. Hanafi, they know. For the sum of opinion, the riwayah and narration, you know, on from the Hanbali authors. They, if there's a permission, they say they need to be relatives. In Nafila, not Fard. And she had the knowledge of the Quran, you know. She will be leading from, you know, standing in the back. and reciting, and the many in front from her family following her. But it's da'if, it's not considered that. Inshallah, in 1 minute or two, we'll start the 6:55. I will give a brief introduction to Al Maqasid and then we'll do it after the inshallah ta'ala. After the break, we'll come back at 7:35. Maqasid al Sharia al Islam. Inshallah, you're going to receive the book next week, whoever who want to get it. And the book that we're going to study is named Maqasid Sharia al-Islamiyya, and the author is named Sheikh Muhammad al-Tahir bin Ashur. One of the contemporary scholars who, mashallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him with a lot of knowledge. He has one of the most known tafsir, Tahrir al-Tamir, very eloquent and extensive in knowledge. And the book of Maqasid al-Sharia, one of the unique books that he wrote, and kind of completing one of the great work done in this subject, which is the subject of the Maqasid, by Al-Imam al-Shatibi, rahimahullah ta'ala. When we talk about Maqasid al-Sharia, is the intent and the objective of the Sharia. Why do we have Sharia? The thing is, when you look at the creation, and it's nice to put things in perspective and look at the big picture. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created man and he created Adam alayhi salam to be a vicegerent on earth. And qadiyat al-khilafa wal-istikhlaf, the fact that someone is a vicegerent on earth, and this is element that we already studied in the Aqidah. Allah made this universe to function according to law, a divine law. A divine law is an equation in the thesis that the well-being of the universe depends on the righteousness of the humankind. This is an action into the creation of Allah. The well-being of the universe depends on the righteousness of the human being. Corruption, deviation, that you see in the universe, its source is the evil of the human being and the jinn. ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس. Corruption being apparent in the land and the sea because of what people have done. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he sent Adam, before he sent Adam, قَالَ وَعَلَّمَهُ وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Adam all the names. But some people, when they say names, you know, it means like he said, oh, this is a paper, this is a microphone, this is a glass, and eat it, and that's it. But it's more profound than that. Because the names, it means the sciences. Because if tell you, define to me the liquid in this bottle, you're going to say water. Say, what is water? So the definition can extend to give me even the chemical composition of the water. And then the most important of knowing the names is to know the wadifa, the purpose of everything that you have, what you're going to need it for. You know the fire is needed for what purpose, the water for what purpose. So the name here, it comes to give you the way how to use what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created for you. And that is all the science is about. Or the invention that happened. Or the, you know, the when you take, for example, raw material to discover what they can do for you. From the cotton you come to get, you know, to have material. From the gas or the petroleum you get to have gas, you get to have this. All of that is knowledge. So this is our, the names. And the most amazing thing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gift to the humankind, that everything created for him and subservient to him. And then the intellect that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided for a human being as a gift, the intellect will help him to discover, to invent, to put things at the service of the humankind. But this, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it to be in a structure, and this structure, how to deal with this element that Allah gave you, how to deal with this gift. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the constitution. This is the Sharia. So the Sharia, it can summarize in two statements. Do and do not do. This is exactly the Sharia that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed to Adam alayhi salam. Say, eat from everything, do not eat from this tree. That's Sharia. So the Sharia is the time of the prayer. Khair, inshallah. We'll stop here, bi-idhnillah, and we'll meet you after the break at 7:35 or so. Jazakum. If you want to change the times, you know, I'm open for that. Whatever you suggest, you are welcome. Meet you after the prayer, inshallah.